This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Dear family of NLC, relatives and friends, Shalom. Welcome to our 66th anniversary service. Although we cannot gather physically, we're still filled with gratitude for God's care and protection. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you His favor and grant you His peace. Let's join in unison to celebrate NLC's birthday and give God praise this morning.
Share Happy birthday!
生日快乐!
NLC 生日快乐!
NLC 生日快乐! Happy birthday!
Good morning, church. Let us enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Let us give thanks to him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
O church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ, our captain. But now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies. An army bold, whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captain. And with the sword that makes the wound the goal, we will fight with faith and valor. When faith with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure, and Christ will have the price for which he died. Inheritance of nations. Arise, shine, for your light has come. Arise, shine, for the risen sun. Lift your eyes, we are his radiant bride. Arise,
standing tall. Yes, church, let us arise and tell to the world that there is no other name to save, but only the name of our Jesus Christ, our Lord. As we arise and accomplish what God has commanded us to do, there will be disappointments and hurdles and obstacles along the way. But let us not lose heart, because God has promised us that He will be with us in a fire, in a flood. So let us persevere, because God is forever faithful, perfect in love, and He is sovereign over all things.
There is
find strength within the sorrow. There is beauty in our tears, and you meet us in the morning with a love that cuts down fear. You are working in our waiting, sanctifying us when beyond our understanding. You are teaching us to trust. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten.
Let us pray together. Great is thy faithfulness, O God. We worship and adore you, for you are faithful forever. Perfect in love, and you are sovereign over us. And because of who you are, we are living with faith in Christ, peace with God, and eternal hope in Christ. Thank you for being with us and not give up on us, even when we are lukewarm towards loving you and loving people. Thank you for being gracious and merciful to us. Thank you for leading your church for the past 66 years of gospel ministry. And thank you for allowing your church to participate in your mission of saving souls for your glory. And may your church continue to be grateful people of God. May your church continue to live out our faith as we go and make disciples. May we always be ready to preach the gospel, give thanks for the gospel, and honor Christ with our lives. Today, as we celebrate your church's 66th anniversary, at this time, we humble ourselves before your holy presence. We confess our wrongdoings to you, Lord. We confess there are times we didn't live out our faith in you. There are times we are not interested in the gospel mission. There are times we are not interested in making new friends so as to bring them to Christ. We confess that we are more interested on the worldly things rather than the things of above. And so I pray that today's preaching of your word will renew us, will help us to change our desire and our interest so that we will humble ourselves, pursue holiness, and exalt Christ. And please help your servant who is preaching today. May the words of Reverend Joshua Ting and the meditations of our heart be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. May your words strengthen your church to continue the gospel ministry. May your words grant us assurance of our salvation in Christ. And if it is your will, grant each one of us the love and passion to pursue the living principle of faith, life, and mission. Take us and use us in your kingdom, for you are faithful forever, you are perfect in love, and you are sovereign over us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today's scripture passage is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24 to 27. Let us listen to God's word with reverence. Do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air. But I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified.
Morning. Shalom. The Bible says, this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. We thank God for this special day. This is the day NLC celebrate her 66th anniversary. We thank God for the past 66 years, how God has sustained NLC with His overwhelming grace. We thank and praise God for blessing and using NLC for the advancement of His kingdom and for the edification of His people, and continue to use NLC to proclaim the gospel of Christ, continue to make disciples of all nations. This morning, as we gather, even though unable to gather on site, but by His grace, we're still able to gather on this platform to celebrate and to give thanks for his faithfulness over the past 66 years. As we look back, especially in the last 1.5 to 2 years, the pandemic has caused the church to rethink, to reset, and to reformulate, and continue to move on to make disciples of all nations, and to make disciples that will continue to follow him in the authentic way, to impact our family, to impact our community, and to impact the nation for God's glory's sake. As faithful followers of Christ, we need to ask God to help us always to reflect the nature of our faith, the mission of our life. As we anticipate the next 5 to 10 years, as the big family of NLC, we have to ask God, what is his desire of our church, of you and I, as his disciples? This morning, we will look at the text. We read the text, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 to 27. In this passage, Paul basically challenged you and I. We are all heavenly bound pilgrims. You and I, just like the books written by John Bunyan, Pilgrim Progress. Every one of us, when we become followers of Christ, as we become disciples of Christ, we embark on a spiritual journey, a heavenly bound pilgrimage, a heavenly bound pilgrimage. And we ask God to help us how to really live out our faith. We believe faith is about life, and life is about mission. And faith challenges us to really know Christ. And life challenges us to experiencing Christ. And mission will challenge us to proclaim Christ. So let's go to God's Word, and would like to learn from Paul to be heavenly bound pilgrims. How can you and I to live out Christ-centered life? Well, if we look at the text, chapter 9, verses 24 to 27, we have to know how actually Paul write the books. In the previous chapter, chapter 8, and Paul talks about the so-called the freedom in Christ. But Paul talked about the principle of love when we exercise our freedom in Christ. That's a principle of love governing the way that would make decision, they would live out our life. But it's interesting enough, if we look at the text from chapter 8 to 9, when you come to chapter 9, again, Paul talks about and how he is willing to give up his apostolic right to financial support so he could present the gospel free of charge to the Corinthians believers. And he goes on by saying that he's most willing to give out any and every right for the sake of winning men and women to Jesus Christ. And he is also excited about the reward of doing something for nothing in ministry. And then finally comes to this passage, verses 24 to 27. Well, we can concludes saying that what Paul tried to say in chapter 8 and chapter 9 is he points out the fact that he is not living for himself. He does not live his life for himself. And he also doesn't live out his life for others, but rather he lives out his life for Christ, for the sake of the gospel, for the advancement of the kingdom. So basically, Paul tried to portray the picture as a messenger of Christ. And Paul challenged himself and also challenged you and I. We are a pilgrims on this spiritual journey. And we have to understand some of the crucial principle in order for you and I to live a life that would pleasing to God and that would glorify Him. So in this passage, let's learn the lesson, the principle, and how to be a heavenly bound pilgrims, faith, life, and mission. Let's look at text, verse 24. Verse 24, it says that, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may attain it." In the other translation, NIV, do you not know that in the race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Well, the first thing, Paul challenged you and I as a heavenly bound pilgrim. Run to win. Run to win. Well, if we pay closely to verse 24, this verse basically, Paul begins with what appears to be a rhetorical question. Do you not know? In the race, all runners run, but only one receives the prize. So basically, Paul asking a question, but in a very rhetorical or hypothetical way. What actually Paul put up a question, he expects all the Corinthians believers understand what he is referring to. Because during those days, there is a so-called Isthmian game. It's a little bit similar to what we have today, Olympic game. Isthmian game is almost identical to Olympic. Basically, they also have different type of sports event. They have athletic event. They have running event. They have different kind of competition. So Paul now referred to the running event, and he says that all the runners run, but only one will receive the prize. That means only one will win. Then Paul says, so run that you may attain it in such a way that we will get the prize. So it is interesting because this Paul challenged you and I. As a heavenly bound pilgrims, we need to run to win. That means the attitude that we should have. That means the effort that we should put in. Paul, as a matter of fact, it make a comparison. And during those times at the Isthmian game, when you engage, when you compete in a game, and basically, you enter the contest to win. That's the spirit. That's the attitude. And because that's what the game is all about. That's what the contest is all about. It's about winning, to win the contest. So Basically, what Paul actually challenged you and I, as a heavenly bound pilgrims, we need to run to win. It talks about both the attitude and the spirit. What Paul actually challenged you and I is the way that we live our life on this earth. Do not live your Christian life as a loser. What Paul basically says is that we are victors. When we believe in Jesus and make Christ our personal Lord and Savior, then by His grace, we overcome the power of sin. By His grace, we overcome the temptation. By His grace, we're able to overcome all the pressures, the troubles, the difficulties. We're able to rise above all these difficulties, all this pressure. So what Paul challenged you and I today, heavenly bound pilgrims, you and I run to win. The attitude, the spirit that we have. And also, it talks about basically is we would give whatever we have and then to win the race. That's the attitude. That means that when we say we make Christ the Lord, our Savior, that means we surrender all to Him. That we give everything that we have to Him, to make Him our Lord, our Savior. So it is important that we need to learn this lesson. Run to win. But in reality, it is quite true that as believer, as follower of Christ, we face with a lot of challenges. We face with a lot of temptation. On one hand, we plant our foot firmly in this present and perishable world, the temporal world. But on the other hand, we plant our foot in the future, the imperishable, the eternal. So there's always a kind of a tension between the two. And sometimes we may go extreme. Either we live in the present with the little thought of the eternal, or we live in the eternal with the little thought of the present. But Paul cautions us, run to win. It means that in the reality, even though we understand we do not belong to this world, but we live in this world, and every day we are engaging the race as a heavily bound pilgrims. We are running the race. This is what Paul actually tried to portray. I mean, when he writes 2 Timothy chapter 4, and he said, I have fought the good fight, and I have finished the race. And basically, it talks about this is life. Our Christian life on the daily basis, and it's so real. We live in this world, but we are not of this world. But how can we strike the balance? So Paul challenged us to have that winning attitude. The winning attitude, it means that always make Christ our Lord. Always put Christ first. And then to please Him. And then to always to have Christ in view of all the things that we engage. And all for His glory. And all for His sake. And this is what an athlete would do. I mean, when he engaged in the contest. The only thing he's concerned is, I want to win. So run to win. As heavily bound pilgrims, Paul will challenge you and I. Run like the one that will win the race. And in the reality, we know it bounds to have challenges. It bounds to have temptation, difficulties. But we always focus on Christ and to win this race. And also, I think it is quite important to realize that running the race on this earth, because our focus is on Christ, that means we'll make any decision based upon our relationship with Christ. The winning attitude is not about the contest itself, but it's about the value. It's about the value because it talks about the price. The price during those times, the winner will get something like a wreath, not a crown itself, but a wreath that actually made of a pine or ivy leaves, a pine leaves of ivy leaves. It's just temporal. So it's not about the crown itself. It's not monetary value, but it's symbolic value. So when Paul challenged us to run to win, it talks about the value. As heavily bound pilgrims, we know we are running the race. The moment we accept Christ, we embark on this spiritual pilgrimage. And we know Christ is our Lord, our Savior. And we want to make Him our Lord and put Him first in our life. So the value needs to be transformed inside out. And Paul challenged you and I. For those runners who run for a temporal, perishable wreath and crown, yet they would give their very best. But for us, we are after the imperishable prize. We should even more giving all to our God, to our Lord. So that's the attitude. Run to win. Brothers and sisters, are you a winner on this spiritual pilgrimage? May God help you and I to focus on the imperishable prize, the glory of God, and then to always to focus upon Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. And as we move on to verse 25, Paul's challenge you and I as a heavenly bound pilgrims, not only to run to win, but secondly, Paul challenge you and I as heavenly bound pilgrims, endure the agony. Verse 25, every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. NIV reads, everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. It is interesting to look at verse 25. What Paul's saying here is to endure the agony. Again, we have to go back to the background. For every athlete that engaged in the contest, every freeman during that time can join the contest. And it's quite interesting. Paul used this word, everyone who competes. The word compete, the original text, has the words equivalent to the English language, agonize,
to agonize. Compete, that means agonize. And what actually means is it requires the whole effort. It requires every ounce, every flesh that you have and to put into practice. And it says that into strict training. It's quite interesting. That means the other verse, the other translation use self-control. What Paul actually tried to say is the process of entering the contest needs a lot of so-called training. And those training will require a lot of sacrifices. A lot of sacrifices. Because when it talks about agony or agonize, it talks about both the attitude and both the real thing. Because that training, it lasts more than 10 months. And during those 10 months period, the athlete would have a tight schedule. There's a time to do this, time to do that. And also there is a tight schedule or kind of a requirement that certain things that you're unable to do, you cannot indulge yourself according to your desire, but you have to control it. Your diet, for instance, what food you can take, what other foods that you have to refrain. So all this, it becomes a requirement and it causes the kind of agony, quote unquote. It brings a lot of discomfort and it brings a lot of pain. It brings a lot of the so-called inconvenience. And all this, Paul challenged you and I, as heavily bound pilgrims, we have to endure the agony. It is true. When we talk about faith is life, we realize that we are not only practicing and learning our faith inside a church setting, church building, but rather is on a daily basis. And every day, we have certain kind of rules and regulation to stick with. And that's our faith that put into practice, that have a kind of a blueprint that we have to follow. And that's the Word of God. As we read His Word, as we meditate, and the Holy Spirit will convict us and the things that we need to engage, and those things that we have to refrain and or we avoid. And this is faith and life. We cannot separate our faith from our life. Faith is materialized through life. So that means it requires a lot of practices that involves sacrifice, that involves a certain price that you have to pay, that maybe have to let go of your right, let go of yourself, and even maybe have to sacrifice some of your possession, your time, your energy, or you have to give up your like, your interests, your whatever that would stop you, quote unquote, to live out Christ in the real situation. Or we have to rethink what are the hindrances that would cause us to slip away from this spiritual pilgrimage. So this is what Paul challenged you and I as heavenly bound pilgrims, not only to run to win, but secondly, to endure the agony. It also points out the tremendous effort that we have to put in order to win. So that's why as a disciple of Christ, especially in this so-called pandemic time, our life being changed due to the pandemic. But those changes, we ask God to help us to really reflect and then to make changes accordingly, but that also empower with our belief, our values in Christ, and to live out Christ, how to be more loving, more caring, more compassionate, more empathy with people. And we will take the initiative to walk to the other person, to enter another person's world, and to really understand his or her situation, and willing to pay the price. Endure the agony. It means that we are willing to let go for his sake. We are willing to give up for his sake, whether it is our resources, our time. So agony, it means you pull out yourself. It may entail difficulties. It may entail discomfort. Again, it may entail certain kind of challenges. It may entail certain losses. But to endure the agony is part of this spiritual pilgrimage. As a heavenly-bound pilgrims, Paul talk about, we have to endure the agony. Remember, Paul says, those athletes, they are after the perishable crown, the prize, perishable. They already agonized throughout the training and to give up a lot of things. But you and I, we are receiving the imperishable, the eternal, incorruptible prize. Even more, we should be more willing to give up and to let go, to follow Christ and to endure the agony through this spiritual pilgrimage process. May God help you and I to really see this important principle. First, run to win. Secondly, endure the agony. Let's move on to verse 26. Paul says, so I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air. NIV version says, therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. It's interesting. Paul used vivid picture that every Corinthians they can identify with, because Isthmian's game or Olympic game, there are some other games during those times. I mean, for the Greeks, for the Corinthians, they are all familiar with all the sports event. So this picture, the first one is run. The second picture, boxing, is part of those games. So for the Corinthians, they know what actually Paul's talking about. So the third principle, Paul challenged you and I as heavenly bound pilgrims, not only to run to win, to endure the agony, but also press on toward the goal. Press on towards the goal. If we look at the text, basically, Paul points out we should not practice for any event without a goal. Right? When we practice an event, when we engage in the event, when we practice, we do a lot of training, there's always a clear goal. You set your goal. You don't enter the contest without a goal. When you join the Olympic, or when you enter a basketball game, enter any kind of a sport event, a contest, there's always a goal. Maybe the goal is to win, maybe win number one, win number two. It all depends on how you know where you are at that moment. But basically, Paul challenged you and I, we press on towards the goal as a heavenly bound pilgrims. It is interesting because the first picture, it talks about running, and do not run aimlessly. Well, this is quite obvious when we look at this picture, because Paul did mention in other texts like 2 Timothy chapter 4. And Paul says that I have fought the good fight and I have finished the race. And it means that there's a clear goal that Paul knows where he's running, why he's running, where he's running to. And the same thing with Philippians chapter 3, verse 14. And it says that we forget the past and we focus on what lying ahead, and then we press on towards the goal. So what Paul actually challenged us is, as disciples of Christ, as a heavenly bound pilgrims, we know where we are going. We want to live a life that would glorify God. And we want to glorify Him by making disciples of all nations. And we want to engage to proclaim the gospel of Christ and to be His witness in every circumstances that we are in. So there is a clear goal. We press on towards the goal. So that means when we live our life out there, we have to ask God to help us. Anything that would stop us from achieving the goal, we have to ask God to give us the strength, the wisdom to overcome, and really to engage. It is interesting to look at the second picture. It says boxing. And it says that I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. Beating the air is also quite interesting because in the original term, there are possible interpretation. One is when beating the air, it means that during the contest, you try to beat your opponent, but you miss the punch. So that missing the punch is just like beating the air. Well, that's quite, I think that's quite understandable. But I think another interpretation also helps us to understand. As a boxer, he needs a lot of time to practice. So beating the air is a picture, a boxer during his practice. Maybe he's inside a ring, and then he's beating the opponent, but there's no one there except him. So he's doing all the beating, but all the beating, as a matter of fact, is beating the air. Why? Because there's no opponent around. That's called shadow boxing. So it's kind of practicing. What actually Paul tried to say is, it is important that you are not doing shadow boxing. You are now in the ring. You are beating your opponent. So what Paul tried to say is, we have to really sure where our goal is, to press on toward the goal. May God help you and I as disciple of Christ. What is your goal as you pursued your life on this earth? Are you glorifying Him in all the things that you do? Where is God? Where is Christ in your life? And the role of Christ in your life when you make decision, when you engage different things in life. The third principle, press on towards the goal to glorify Him in whatever we do, wherever we are. Finally, verse 27, Paul challenges us as heavenly bound pilgrims, run to win, endure the agony, press on towards the goal. The final things, discipline to fulfill the mission. Discipline to fulfill the mission. Look at verse 27. But I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. Or NIV says, no, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. We just pay attention to one word. The word disciplined, or the NIV translate as strike a blow. While in the original word, it means I bruise my body, especially your face. That means your face being hit, beaten, and then there's a bruise. While that actually means something happened, being beaten, knocked down by the opponent, and then so that you're being knocked out, you're being KO by your opponent, quote unquote. So the word the ESV use discipline, the NIV strike a blow. All different translations have a very equivalent meaning. That means it's a strict discipline. That means you want to bring under control. You see, Paul tried to challenge us. As heavenly bound pilgrims, we glorify God by making disciples of all nations. So to proclaim Christ, the mission is important. When we do a lot of Christian things, whether in the church or in our personal life, all this, by doing all that, because we have a clear purpose, is to glorify God. But to glorify God, have to carry on through fulfilling the mission. And that's what Paul tried to say. In chapter 9, he talks about he proclaimed the gospel, he shared the gospel, and he wanted to winning men and women without them to paying any price. But it's quite interesting, when Paul talked about this, in verse 27, and then he ends up with, I myself should be disqualified. Or he says that I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. It is quite interesting, because when he says, I preach, or I spoken, or I declare, the ideas of the word also is quite interesting. It's about like an announcer. When the victors, when the sport events end, then the champions came out, the victor. So the announcer will make will pronounce that someone from a sport region, and then the father's name, and then the athlete names, and then they'll become the champion and have won the prize. And Paul says that as that announcer who spoke, who proclaimed, but he disqualified to have that honor. So what Paul tried to say is, this is our mission. Our mission is to proclaim Christ, but we have to put ourselves under control. And that strict discipline, it means that it's not something just outside, going through a strict kind of a schedule, a lot of demanding, a lot of training, a lot of sacrifice. It's not about that. As a matter of fact, when Paul tried to use the word discipline or to being knocked down, it talks about to let go of your right, not to depending on yourself. It's not by your own strength, by your own might, by your own wisdom, by your own experience, by your own resources that we are able to fulfill the mission, but rather to really going through the process to discipline your life that would depending on the work of the Holy Spirit, and then to rely on the Lord of the harvest. And I think that's what Paul tried to challenge you and I. Discipline to fulfill the mission. Faith is about life. Life is about mission. It's not about ourselves. It's about how Christ lived through us. Christ lived in us, and Christ lived through us, so that we are able to be living testimony of His grace, His love to the others around us. And we're able to continue in order to proclaim the gospel to the people. We continue to rely upon the strength, the power of the Holy Spirit, and to claim the promise of God, and then to experience how He transformed lives around us. So discipline to fulfill the mission. Yes, faith is about life. Life is about mission. As we celebrate 66 years of God's overflowing grace, we have to ask ourselves, what does God demand or require us as a family, NLC, and as an individual, as we move on to the next 3, 5, and 10 years? May God help you and I, as heavenly bound pilgrims, let's run to win, endure the agony, press on towards the goal, and finally, discipline to fulfill the mission. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word, and help us to meditate, to understand, and to put into practice, so that as heavenly bound pilgrims, our faith being materialized through life, empowered by mission. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us now pray for our church. Pray for Newton Life Church. Praise God as we can join hearts to celebrate our church anniversary today. We thank God for 66 years of His faithfulness and goodness to NLC. As we go forward, let us uphold the church ministries with our prayers. Pray for God's grace, protection, guidance, and direction as we fulfill His will and purpose. I just say go to it. Yeah. Our Father in Heaven, thank you that we are celebrating this 66th church anniversary together. We thank you that we are all one in Christ, and we pray that as members of your body, your Holy Spirit will knit us together in the bonds of unity and love. We pray that you would continue to equip each one of us, both individually and in our ministries, with talents and gifts that may be used to your praise and glory. We lift up your church ministries into your hands. Protect us from the enemy who seeks to destroy and cause division among your church. Help us to not be motivated by selfishness, but in humility and love to glorify you alone. Give wisdom to our church pastoral team. Align their hearts with yours, their ideas with yours, and their will with yours. Guide them and lead them to fulfill your will and purpose. We pray, Lord, that your hands will be kept open over your church as we embark on another year journey ahead of us. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father in Heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Dear family members of Newton Life Church, relatives and friends, Shalom! Welcome to our 66th anniversary Thanksgiving service. Today, NLC marked another year of ministry. May God bless every individual member of the body of Christ as we rededicate ourselves to the task God has set before us, rededicate our lives to serve God and accomplish His will. During this stabilization period, let us continue to worship at home, wear appropriate clothing, stay focused, and let us worship God with awe and reverence. Please also take note that our children worship on Zoom will no longer be on Saturday 4 p.m. It will begin from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. on Sunday morning. Hope to see your children joining us for a fun time of worship, scripture memory, and learning about God's Word. Lastly, brothers and sisters are encouraged to exercise faith in giving as this is the desire of God. Proverbs chapter 3 verse 9 to 10 says, "Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruit of all your crops, then your barns will be filled to overflowing and your vats will brim over with new wine." May we honor the Lord and experience Him in our giving. That's all for today's announcement. See you next week!
Receive a benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace forever and ever. Amen.